rolling on dubs. How you feel?
On one hand, it seems dodgy. But on the other, I guess that's just hip-hop.
You know, whether he got it from an idea from hearing the record, the MIA, or not.
I think that was the case, though, or not?
Yeah, I feel like he heard that first, before they did it. It's a huge record, man, that he made. Fine, okay, you know what? At least I know I'm not crazy. If I sampled it, you know, maybe this guy sold a million. Fine, but it lets me know that I'm not crazy. At least I know I'm on the right track. A lot of these people, oh, they get all upset and all crazy. Like, for what? What are you going to get upset for? You didn't make the original. Yeah, you took it anyway.
You're going to have the purists who denounce it. On the other side of the fence, you're going to have hundreds of thousands of radio listeners, club goers. They just like the Dre song and they like Snoop and they don't care. So you can scream and shout all you want about how Dre ripped somebody off, but he doesn't care and he's getting paid.
Ira Science.
There is something that I know about production, and that's that sometimes you have to pay your dues. And a lot of people came into the game hitting people off of records to sample, or looping records for people and, you know, for other producers, or helping them out on beats and not getting the proper credit for it. And some of those people are the biggest producers right now because they paid their dues and made the connections and were able to do that.
It's definitely a hit record, but the history behind the beat is very questionable, to say the least.
The reason that he used that sample is not because he was lazy. You know, he used it because the sample was so hot, he had to use it. That it was that good, that it was gonna make the song. They discovered the sample, sure, but Dre was the one who put it on a stage in front of everyone, and then everyone said, yes, that is indeed a great musical hook.
Guys like Puff Daddy and Dr. Dre, they're spending so much time getting on television and in awards and stuff like that, that they don't really have time to be in the stores digging. So what they have is these kind of crew around them of producers. A lot of the times they'll take credit for tracks that, you know, they really maybe tweaked a little, but there's some guy who really came up with the whole concept. So Melman on the 2001 album is definitely the guy that had that sound down.
As well as Melman, who bought the next episode beat off Jared, one of Dre's ghost producers is keyboard expert Scott Storch, thought by many to be the main inspiration behind Dre's new sound.
I like Dre, but I also know that Scott played most of the shit. He'll sit there with a keyboard and a drum machine, and I never seen nobody do this before. He'll tap out the beat with his hand while he's playing the keyboards on the other hand, the piano. That's why his beats are like boom, always straight four, because he's boom, and the other hand, he's playing the piano, trying to figure out what it's going to be. He's like, this is how I make all my beats.
So he come up with a Still Dre?
Yeah.
That piano?
Oh, no doubt, no doubt. No doubt, no doubt, yeah. No doubt. You know, I asked him, like, how do you feel about all these records that everybody thinks Dre made, that you made? He's like, oh, fuck it, look at my house. I'm like, yeah, you're right. The team together is hot. You know, you could tell because every record they worked on together is hot. And this is what Scott tells me. He's like, look, man, Dre does what he does, man. I just give them tracks. They make records off of them. That's true. You know, he'll fix it anyway, but the foundation is basically Scott.
Also, the team technique has been used by one of music's biggest names, Puff Daddy.
Even when Puffy was reigning for a minute, he had a whole staff of producers. He would just pay them to go make beats, and when he liked it, that was his beat, produced by Puff Daddy. He was paying people to be in the lab making shit.
The fact is, great samples are getting harder and harder to find. The next episode isn't the first and probably won't be the last beat with a dodgy history. As the competition for the best breaks and beats hots up, it's more than likely that further stories will surface about beat selling and beat stealing. When you look at the way some samples end up on some tracks, you wonder whether certain big name producers can take as much credit as they do. No one's ready to deal with us. But hip-hop has always been music on the edge.
To whom it may concern, this goes out to anybody who's doing the bullshit straight up. Yo, everybody's calling me, my lawyer, everybody on this yo, did you scratch such and such name or this, that, and the third on a record for a hook? Y'all keep calling me on that shit, man, and y'all supposed to be hip-hoppers and all that and letting the industry control the rules of the hip-hop world that we made? Y'all need to knock that shit off. That's some greedy-ass fake bullshit. Y'all are violating straight up and down. So while y'all keep on faking the funk, we gonna keep on walking through the darkness carrying our torches. Underground will live forever, baby. We just like roaches, never dying. No one's ready to deal with us.
One thing you can be sure of, The Edge by Dave McCallum. Originally made into a beat by Vic, then replayed by Melman and Dre, will definitely not be the last Black Market break.